we're going to be talking about how we got the space shuttle and how we ended up deserving what we got. But this is going to be a little bit different than the kind of happy face histories or rockets to the moon stuff. I'm glad it's kind of a small group because we're going to be talking a little bit more engineering. But, and this is going to be one of the different things, we talk about having to optimize things in engineering. Importantly, you know, we talk temperatures, pressures, voltages, et cetera, et cetera. But in this development, the space shuttle was kind of a groundbreaker in that not only did you have to optimize temperatures, pressures, and so on, you had to optimize cost and schedule. We can make strong arguments about how the latest new rocket that the, that NASA is building, the SLS, was all designed by a government committee. This was worse. This was designed, in effect, and we're going to see all the compromises, which is the point of the talk. It was designed by the Bureau of the Budget. This is how we ended up with the space shuttle we deserved rather than the one we wanted.
And to just look ahead, the question I'm going to ask at the end is, ultimately, was this a really good idea or not?
Surprise. I have a slide at the end, and I vacillated back and forth this morning about whether I should include it, but to show that engineering optimization and cost-benefit schedule optimization is a universal concept, I'll show you example B. And that's all I'll say. Anyway, so, yeah, I wanted to have one of these. I'm sorry, I'll go back to this 100 times. This is one of my favorite movies. That was how we were supposed to go into space, right? Right? Yeah.
Is that an airplane that...
As my father would say, mon Dieu.
So that's a 2000 airplane.
This is from one of the greatest... I think it's like one of the top 20 movies ever made in history. It's from 2001. This... you can still get it. You need to see, wrong answer. Oh, look, do you want to stop? We can go and stream, I'm sorry. This is a beautiful design. It's beautiful, it's organic. And that, of course, is when you used to be able to fly Pan Am. Of course, we know that we don't have a shuttle like that, nor do we have Pan Am anymore. But that was the visions that we all had starting in the mid-60s. And that was cool. And boy, this was all going to be great. I mean, think of it. The idea was we were going to be having it after Apollo. We were going to have a space station. Yeah, okay, well, that was part of von Braun's plan. That was what we really wanted. The Russians were already putting up space stations. And we were going to have shuttle going back and forth to it. You know, you have to service it. You need to commute back and forth to work. And, of course, that was going to be... We were going to be going all the time. These things were going to be going off to the point where they, you know, it was like you don't see news articles about a flight leaving for London anymore. Well, this is going to be so boring. The only way you'd know is, you know, if you were nearby and it disrupted your picnic outside. We weren't going to be hauling cargo or a lot of it. This was a shuttle for people. Oh, yeah, you'd carry a couple tons of goodies and maybe throw out a satellite, but... The whole idea is we're going to be shuttle like a shuttle bus. That was the original concept. But it was going to be free. It was going to be, by today's standards, it was going to be free. Didn't quite work out that way. Unfortunately. So here's the thing. When we went to the moon, that beautiful booster, the Saturn V, the one that's, what, over here? That cost $1 billion a pop. Actually, closer to about one and a quarter to one and a half billion every time we launched it in today's dollars. That's not sustainable. You just can't do that. I mean, it is crazy. And even in the early 60s, they were aware of this. This whole idea of reusability that you hear today was not a new concept. They were all very, very astutely aware of this. The amount of time and effort needed to launch a rocket one of the early studies they did for the early Atlas rocket and at the time the Boeing 707, they both had comparable complexity, comparable weight, comparable, believe it or not, a 707 stored energy in the fuel is roughly that of an Atlas rocket, one of the early rockets. Now, why does one take a dozen hours, a couple dozen hours at worst, to turn around after a flight, a dozen people hours, and the Atlas needs 60 to 100,000 hours to get it off, and it's only once? Obviously, back then they knew this was not a sustainable model. And it was very reasonable, and lots of ideas. And we started doing this. Starting in the late 50s, we designed the X-15. This was more than just going higher and faster and all the other stuff. We were exploring regimes of flight that we had never seen before. Now we're starting to go up into space. The early rocket planes, okay, they probably went up 50, 70, 100,000 feet maybe. Going Mach 2, that was a big deal. Well, now we're going to be really screaming along. We want to get up to Mach 6. And once you get up around there, the laws of physics kind of change. We're not talking about aerodynamics being defined by Navier-Stokes and all the other great equations. It now gets into very, very, very different physics. This isn't your average aerodynamics that, you know, will keep your Cessna up. We don't know how to control an aircraft when there's no air. Kind of useful with all those wings and flappy parts. The idea of going incredibly fast through the atmosphere creates horrible heating. Thousands and thousands of degrees. How do you design an aircraft to sustain that? Most every metal is going to, not quite vaporize, but you know, it's going to be one heck of a repair job when you get back home. So you're going to need this. So, sir, come on in, sit down, enjoy.
Oh, no, he might have to go soon.
Oh, well. And again, we were going to be exploring this new regime of flight where we're talking hypersonic flight. So, that wasn't the end of it. We were going to be doing another vehicle called the X-20. This was more of an Air Force weapons project. And it was started right around the time of the X-15. And they called it dinosaur, not that it was a dinosaur, but we were going to be doing dynamic soaring, as they called it. This was actually an old German Second War idea, and the Germans wanted to do this for a successor to the V-2, where you would actually boost up, get up a big head of steam, and then skip, 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 they called it dynamic soaring, across the atmosphere to wherever you're going to go. The idea would be, okay, that bypasses any kind of nasty heating issues, because you're spending most of the time out of the atmosphere until you slow down. And you got a nice piece of range out of that. Very interesting ideas. And the Air Force was going to be doing this. We're going to be launching on a rocket, landing like an airplane. This was going to work. This really was. They were actually building this. They had...
So the obvious question is, why is it technically feasible?
Whoops.
I'm terrible. Goes as high as it can, mm-hmm. It turns on a rocket engine and escapes. Which is an obvious way.
All right, you asked the question. A slide I dropped.
I'm obviously, if you could do it, you would do it. But there must be a reason why you can't. Or so far you can't.
There we go. Yeah. I dropped this slide, but you started this.
No, I know.
This is the tyranny of the rocket equation. We're now getting a little off. I have never put an equation in any of my presentations. This is the very first one. Let's record this on film. That is why. Now, what do we get out of the rocket equation? Very, very simple. The efficiency of your propellant, we call it specific impulse, ISP, gravity, and the log of your ratio of masses, full versus empty. That's all it is. Your empty mass and your fully loaded mass.
Oh, okay.
And that's it. And what that means, and this drives every rocket design. This was actually developed, oh God, maybe even in the late 19th century, early 20th. This is an old equation. But what it shows is all that extra mass of the rocket is what kills you. This is exactly the reason why we have to have a big dumb booster lift you up, and when it's empty, it still weighs, 100, 200,000 pounds. That's dead weight you have to carry. And so the solution is throw it away or get rid of it, and then use a very efficient, high energy upper stage where your ISP is quite high, your efficiency is very, very high, and now you're not dragging those hundreds of thousands of pounds of dead mass. If you put a rocket on an airplane, you still have the problem of an airplane having to drag its wings, it's all that fuel, and even after the fuel's gone, you're dragging around empty tanks. This is the part of the talk I did not want to go into, but you started it. It's all his fault. He does this. But okay. And delta V is your how much velocity you can get out of it. So if the idea is, if I can shed a couple hundred thousand pounds of booster or 100,000 pounds, I now, that right part of the equation changes to a much more efficient thing. It also explains, because G is so big, force of gravity is so big, why we cannot have nice things like a single rocket launching into space. The numbers are extremely close to the value where you could have a single rocket go into space, but you have effectively, on a practical level, no payload. And so if you don't have a payload, what's the point? Where this does work is you gotta have a small value for G. Like on the moon. The only the only rocket that could go into orbit using a single stage was the Apollo Lunar Module, when it fired its engine and was able to go up into orbit with one engine. That's the tyranny of the rocket equation. And now we've beat that to death. You started this. He does this. Okay. And that's why I didn't want to have this as part of the talk. Okay, let's keep on going here. So, our big problem was we just didn't know much about high-speed flight. And again, the aerodynamics are very, very different. They're not the standard equations we're used to. And the real, real problem is every time we try modeling this in one of the few wind tunnels that we had, they were all completely inconsistent. The modeling wasn't accurate. And so a vehicle like the X-15 was our only real source of data, and they just absorbed every little bit. So you have real problems with, if I want to have a vehicle that's going to be able to survive in these regimes, and again, they were happy to just get it up around Mach 6 or 8. Now we're talking Mach 25, which is where you're going to be starting your entry into the atmosphere. And that is tough. That is real, real tough. What's your heating going to be like? Traditionally, what we do is we just put a big blunt heat shield, let it burn off, worked like a champ. It really, really did. But now we have to have something reusable. You take a look at those heat shields after an Apollo mission or some of the early ones, they're just charred. Not much left to them. And those are big, heavy, and expensive to replace. You want something reusable. Tough to do. So, you want a space shuttle. What do you want? What's it going to do? Any thoughts? We're going to go to the space station, right? Great. What's it going to do? Well, we're just going to rotate crews and maybe bring up some payload. Okay, fine. What do we have? And these are studies that were done in the late 60s. What do we have that's mature enough where we understand all those problems, especially in hypersonics? About the only thing we can agree on is that we want it to be reusable. We're going to launch it like a rocket and land like an airplane. Okay, that sounds good. Well, let's start scratching out ideas. Oh, this one, the whole idea of putting it on top of a rocket, that doesn't work so well. Think of it this way. You have a long, extremely light, flexible vehicle with a huge source of lift on top. Your bending moments are horrendous. Many models just broke the rocket in half. That's why all the early models had these huge fins on the bottom just to counteract it. Now you have extra weight, now you have aerodynamic losses plus gravity losses. This is a bad idea to put effectively an airplane at the pointy end of the rocket. It really is. And, well, they really struggled with that. So what happens if you don't need wings? Okay, if wings are the problem, you get rid of the wings, right? Good engineering solution. And this is during the 60s, what they really experimented with. If you don't remember 2001, how could I talk about $6 Million Man? We're going to have to send you to remedial pop culture. We have to bring you up to speed.
Bigfoot scared me.
What's that?
The big episode with Bigfoot, the double episode with Bigfoot. $6 Million Man.
I'm glad I missed that one. I can't speak with authority on that.
Woman, year.
No, I really did see 1969.
I saw it in 68 in Cinerama. I was living near Detroit, and we went to, and my dad had no idea what it, I had all the wrong, yeah, and it was that one of those big fancy theaters, and you know, of course, you know, 12-year-old kid, my eyes are like, wow. Yeah, what are they smoking and how do I find some?
Because it keeps them down.
I just found out, today, the Museum of the Moving Image, which used to be the movie museum in the city, is starting in January, doing 6 months traveling exhibit on 2001, so you can get caught up.
You know, at the end when the computer is almost destroyed and it sings Daisy Daisy, that was the original recording from Bell Laboratories
of
the very first computer-generated device.
Yep. And there's a marvelous book that just came out last year, just simply called 2001 or something. It is a brilliant back story on 2001 and all the rest. But anyway, so what happens if you don't need wings? We flew a lot of these. We really did. And well, it solved the problem about having wings. Of course, it didn't solve the problem about controllability. The pilots eventually were able to control it, but without sophisticated fly-by-wire, which wouldn't be invented for another 10 years for aircraft, this was a bad idea. It was a brilliant thing for research, doing work at all the test flight facilities. But trying to build something like this, put rocket engines in it, all the rest, it didn't scale well. The aerodynamics were completely untested in hypersonic speeds, and this was pretty much relegated to a very neat idea, but we're going to move on. But we're going to go to space in a big shuttle and go to our space station, right? Right, just keep nodding. And yeah, we're going to have a monster shuttle. Oh, wait, that's a big shuttle. We have a little bit of a problem here. Oh, we all know that, you know, when you hop on a plane, I mean, a little truck comes up and it just throws all the bags in and buttons it up, off you go. This is what processing of the space shuttle is going to be like. Just roll it into a hangar, drop your next payload in, get it out to the pad, right? Right, of course. This is exactly how it's going to look. This is absurd. Bluntly, when the shuttle was sold to Congress in 1972, it was a bucket of lies. We were going to be going up 50, 70 times a year. Now, if you're using rockets that much, you know, yeah, reusability works. You run the numbers, boy, throwing away 75 boosters, that gets expensive, especially on Saturn V where it's a billion a pop. You can't sustain that. Oh, all that cargo? We're going to carry lots. If you build it, it'll come, right? Nod yes. Nod yes. And it's going to be so damn cheap. We're going to be able to replace every rocket ever made because we're all going to stick it on the shuttle. This caused a bit of a problem. The military wanted to send up their toys. This is the military's dreadnought, if you want to call it. It's kind of a wide-angle thing because it's so big. It's far bigger than a tractor trailer. This is what's called Hexagon, the KH-9 spy satellite.
Space balls.
You know, for years I've been repressing having seen that. Yes, I saw it. I probably chuckled, but again, I've been trying to repress those things, you know, PTSD, you know, after you see movies like that. This is the size of a tractor trailer. This was the most incredible, huge. Again, it was 60-something feet long, weighed in at 20 tons. This was the highest resolution, most amazing spy camera technology ever made. And they were coming off the assembly line, not like sausages, but the military was dedicated to it. It returned a whole bunch of film. It was able to survive 6 months rather than just a few days like the early spy satellites. The pictures were at theoretical resolutions, getting down in some cases down to about 6 inches per pixel. This, if the military drove a lot of the requirements. So no longer do we have a small little, we're going to just bring up people. We need big cargo and heavy cargo brought up. But NASA needed buy-in from the military, and this is what they needed to have set up in the space a lot. Oh, instead of a nice easy launch from Cape Kennedy, we're going to be launching off the West Coast, Vandenberg. Going into a polar orbit. Now you've lost the advantage of the rotation of the Earth. It actually goes against it a little bit. And we have a requirement. If we're going to be using this as a military asset, I want to go up. I want to do some photography. I want to do whatever. I want to be home on the next, even before I go around the Earth once. Huge requirement. Now, a little problem with that. Even though we don't feel the Earth move under our feet, the Earth does rotate. And after 90 minutes of going around, where you launched has now moved about 1,200 miles. You have to be able to fly back. That changes the game tremendously. So now I need a massive payload in terms of size and weight. I have to build another whole launch complex, and I have to be able to scoot across the Earth in order to get back to my original landing spot. These were serious requirements. The only thing is, once you add up all this stuff, these things get big. A large part of it is, for that rocket equation, that ISP term, you need to have incredibly high energy, high performance engines. The only way you're going to do that is with hydrogen and oxygen. Can't use kerosene, can't use methane, can't use all that other fun stuff. The only problem is hydrogen is probably, even in its liquid form, one of the most least dense substances around. It's almost like trying to store fog. And because of that, your tanks are huge. Absolutely mammoth. That's the moon rocket. In order to put all those requirements together, we were talking building for just the booster, something that was easily 300 feet long, just to hold this incredibly lightweight, but very not dense, fuel to get us off the ground. We were talking 30 or 40 engines in order to pull this off. These things were getting crazy size. Not sustainable. Oh, by the way, did I tell you we're on a budget? These were much larger than the 747, which was just starting to head into service. And now you want to build something volumetrically that's several times larger, having to endure launch stresses and all the rest. At least we know how to make airplanes. And the 747 would be easy in comparison. So yeah. Oh, and they thought, why not use a Saturn V first stage with the big fins, because you have the wings on it, to see if it would go. This was just not practical. They went through all kinds of ideas how you could do it. So if you have a booster and an upper stage, which is required by that ugly rocket equation, and you want to recover both, how are you going to do this? Well, you got to have one that big one that brings it up off the ground, the other one that goes into space. They got entertaining in the ideas. We won't talk about interference, shockwaves, and all the rest at the interface, but that's what makes aerodynamicists cry a lot, stay up a lot. Ideas got silly. Like this one. It was going to work. All the rocket equation did. That top part was going to split off, dumping your fuel tanks. I'm mixing a few of the proposals over time, but this was one of them that technically would work. They even thought of, well, should we launch it off a ramp? But no, that's pop culture time. Come on, I watched this. Fireball XL5. Puppets. Oh, never. You guys are hopeless. Anyway, so we all of a sudden realized we have to, shall we say, down select what all of our great original ideas were. Oh, by the way, we were supposed to, well, we can't just have this stuff glide in. Got to put jet engines on it, so that if we miss the runway or we need to go around or divert for weather, well, if we're gliding, you know, gravity always wins, right? Put some jet engines on it, fly around, say it's a bad day, I miss my runway or something. Remember, this is something that's far bigger than the 747. 747 had some pretty big engines on it. You're gonna need a lot of jet engines. I had to look this up. You know how much a JT9D, which is the engine on the 747? That thing weighs in at pushing 10 tons. I'm sorry, 5 tons, 10,000 pounds. And you need a whole bunch of them. And that's dead weight just for in case you miss the runway.
And you'd be carrying some fuel for it.
Yeah. And you know what that rocket equation says? More weight, and that's dead weight, so your M0 is going to be much higher. It's a bad idea. Remember how I said we wanted to go and scoot across about 1,200, 1,500 miles if we are only going to go around once? It turns out NASA embraced that idea. What happens if you have a problem? Say your window breaks, and I have to get home. And it happened early on, or the life support failed, or something big fails. you don't want to spend a lot of time. They turn that into a very smart, what we call an abort mode, that if there's a way to get down, we can get you back to the runway. We can get you back to the launch site. So it wasn't only a Department of Defense requirement. You're going to say, oh, I'm sorry, I thought you were about to ask something. Oh, all that reusability? Well, remember that 300-foot airplane with all the fuel? Well, that had to go. That was, again, remember, this is one of the first times NASA was forced to manage their budget as well as temperatures, pressures, voltages. Oh, and that big tank? Remember, the reason why these things are so big, both of them were carrying all their tank, all their fuel inside. Let's get rid of it all being inside. That just makes it huge. And what are you going to do with a big empty tank as you're in space? So we got rid of the jet engines. Those were going to be over the wings. And this was a nice little picture because it only showed one engine over each one. Again, this is a dreadnought. This was huge. This was 200 feet long. And that was the small one. We had engines over the wings because if they were underneath, they would have been burned up during entry. Oh, and they had little covers so that it would be able to survive. The engines, one of the first things to go. We were going to learn how to glide. We learned very nicely in the X-15. That was a glider coming home. Pilots were actually pretty comfortable with the idea of, you know, a one-shot landing if most of the conditions were good. And almost all the landings in the X-15 went very, very well. Only one dinged. The straight wings, those are real good. Those are fantastic. Especially when you're landing, because low speed, they generate a tremendous amount of lift compared to any other kind of wing shape. Your landings are slow, nice, controllable. Hey, if you're in a glider, it does make sense. The only thing is, there's virtually no lift when you need it way up high in that hypersonic regime, and you need to scoot across 1,200, 1,500 miles of Earth. No cross range. It was just straight in. This did not fulfill the requirement. And so we had to scrap these straight wings. That was a big fight. That was a huge fight. But it was a requirement. And so now we have these triangular delta wings. They work fabulous, absolutely fabulous at high altitudes, be able to maneuver, scoot across the Earth as the Earth is turning away from you, and be able to get to the landing site. And again, they are the only possible way if you have an abort and you have to come home like after one orbit. Absolutely required. Well, now we're going to get rid of that big tank inside the orbiter. We're going to put it on the side or underneath. There was 100 different designs on this. They had big tanks over the wings, under it, tanks all around. But now, instead of a 300-foot booster and a 200-foot shuttle, we're now down to about 100, 110 feet. That's a heck of a lot less metal to bend. And so now it's all shrunk down, but that idea of reusing everything, well, these things are now starting to get thrown away. Interesting things. Oh, and all those fancy liquid boosters that were going to be so efficient, those are kind of expensive, especially if you're going to throw them away. But if you use solid fuel, a heck of a lot cheaper. Now we're making a much smaller rocket. Engineering costs are so much less. You've lost your reusability. Yes, sir.
I have a question.
Go.
When you use liquid fuel, fuel goes into a mechanism, the rocket engine burns. Mm-hmm. When you use solid fuel, does the fuel burn in place? Or does
yep.
it have to be liquefied and put in
place? No. Just like a skyrocket.
Just like a firecracker. Yeah.
Exactly right. Exactly right. Here's a great piece of trivia. Again, we're burning oxygen and hydrogen. in the liquid engines and the main engines that are on the shuttle? What do you get when you burn oxygen and hydrogen? Trivia question. Does that mean, does that mean that the shuttle uses steam engines? Think carefully. It's a steam engine. Work with me. So, really, what we ended up with, this was not going to make everyone happy. But it was the only way we could get a shuttle, and we were kind of committed. They were actually in the process of getting rid of all the other rockets. And then they realized this is not going to end well. And after having the assembly line shut down for a couple years, when they realized that we're not flying weekly, and this was over time. Now, even when they launched it, they knew that all those fantasies that they had weren't going to happen. And they restarted the assembly lines. They really did try to make it work, but it didn't. You know all that money we saved by not building those huge, huge boosters? Those huge 300-foot airplanes to launch everything? Yeah, you saved a huge money in your R&D costs. You pushed it all to your operational budget. And that's where it became expensive. Instead of reusing everything, well, you're throwing stuff away. And those boosters, those solid boosters, which were supposed to be reusable, they were. Almost every one of them they picked up and tried to reuse. It turns out going out in a ship a couple hundred miles out, dragging them back in, refurbishing them, actually was about as expensive as buying them brand new. But you find these things out. So finally we fly. That's a great shot. Office of Management and Budget drove the design. This was unique. It wasn't billions of dollars over budget. It was only a little bit over budget. That was how tightly they ran the whole program.
I have a question.
Sir.
And this may be an incorrect fact, but it's my understanding that this shuttle would never go high enough with something at the synchronous orbit.
No, that's 100% true. It can't go. Not really. All the satellites.
Did they do that at the beginning, or was that just something?
That wasn't even part of the design.
Okay.
That's 100% true. I think the highest it went was servicing the Hubble, which is about 450 miles. But it was never designed to go that high. That would have required a huge amount more energy, and it just simply wasn't in the design spec. What they did do was all the satellites that were to go into geosynchronous orbit, 22,000-ish, 300 miles, all had what we call a kick stage. And you will see everything from TDRS to the COMSATs to whatever, all have a big rocket stage, which is very standard, even in the expendable rockets. They all had these. None of them were going to do directly take it up to 22,000 miles. They would fire off their engine, and then they go into a long looping orbit, down a couple hundred miles to 22,000 miles. And over time, at the top, they speed up, they fire a small engine over and over. Eventually, they synchronize it all at 22,300. But
so the net is the shuttle was and could be used.
I'm sorry, last thing?
The shuttle could be used and was used. Put satellites in synchronous orbit, but not correctly.
Correct. So, it actually was kind of amazing because it was designed for 100 uses. All of them flew less than 35 times-ish. It was hardly used. But it lasted twice as long as we expected. It lasted 30 years. Think of that. It was getting old to the point where parts simply weren't made for it anymore. They were buying parts off of eBay to find it, like ancient processor chips. So anyway, it evolved over time. We were upgrading. About 10 years into it, they doubled the performance of the computers, which were actually pretty good toward the end. All those tiles were not replaced. They didn't replace tiles after each one, but they did come up with new insulation ideas, which were really quite good. And they were quite a bit lighter. They replaced tons of the tiles. They're actually quartz blankets. Worked as good, if not better, than the tiles. Quite a bit lighter, and they worked like a champ. And
better than the ceramic?
Oh, yeah. In the low and moderate temperature range. The ceramic ones still were the only, and they actually improved those very nicely as well. The tiles are not fragile in the sense that, you know, if you touch it, it goes into a million pieces. You could take them, you can drop them, might get chipped, but they were really pretty tough. Think of the forces during launch and entry that they have to go through. If it was that fragile, like, you know, crumbling styrofoam in your hand, well, it certainly wouldn't even survive the launch, much less coming back. And the vast, vast bulk, like 90% of all the tiles, when they retired the shuttle, they were original. They had lasted 30 years, which is a pretty neat trick. So, oh, yeah. You know how economics and physics are kind of universal? We went through that whole nonsense about the evolution, decisions that had to be made. Guess what? Russians didn't steal our plans. They just used the same physics and economics we did. This is exactly what they built. They built the exact same thing, almost, not exactly, close enough, but the same basic mold line, a big expendable rocket to lift it up. And it worked actually pretty well. They flew it once and they ran out of money. Because you think ours was expensive, in the Russian economy, that big booster was terribly expensive. But the aerodynamics are the same in Russia as here. And to be able to optimize cost, it's the same kind of cost that we have here. And so they built very much the same. Yep. Oh, and I have a wonderful video. Yeah. Flew it once at orbit and I cut. Oh, no. They were very big on it. They were very big on it. You know, this was the Russian shuttle ski or whatever people called it. Anyway, blah, 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 amazing flying machine, and that is it, sports fans.
You mentioned they had future upgrades. What were some of the future upgrades?
One thing in particular they really, even from the beginning, they really hated to have in there. And you have this on aircraft. You'll hear what's called an APU, auxiliary power unit. If you ever look at a jetliner, you notice there's a little exhaust at the tail. That's actually a small jet engine that runs that provides hydraulic power just to augment all the bleed air and all the rest from the engines. This is the thing that you have when you don't have a lot of engine thrust, hugely important. On the shuttle, it's the only thing. Now, it's not a jet engine. It was actually powered by hydrazine, catalytic reaction, and which generated like nitrogen steam coming out, very high pressure, used in some applications, used on the X-15. And these were cantankerous as can be and had a nasty problem with catching fire. One shuttle landed on fire with the APU burning. These were a bad idea from square one, and one of the big upgrades, and who's going to cost...
Fuel cell?
Not a fuel cell. This is called an AP, auxiliary power unit, unrelated to the electrical fuel cells, but it was just a way of generating hydraulic pressure. And they were miserable, wretched beasts. What they wanted to replace them with was an electrical hydraulic system, which would have required huge amounts of engineering, because when you're trying to generate that much hydraulic pressure, you need a big energy source. Hydrazine at the time seemed like a great idea. And that was one of the stumbling blocks. But they were ready to spend a couple hundred million to upgrade the shuttles and have a much more reliable, because that was probably the biggest single point of failure on the whole shuttle. The other thing they wanted to do was upgrade the fuel cells. They were 30-year technology, and we'd advanced. There were a couple other...
But tell us what actually killed the shuttle.
Columbia.
Yeah, things happened.
Okay. When Columbia was lost, and that was 2003, we'd already lost Challenger. The investigation board came up with a critical recommendation, and NASA accepted it. Now, again, remember, at this time, we're getting into a 25-year-old shuttle, which is showing its age. Wiring is getting to be a problem. They have 10,000 problems. And they said, okay, you will finish assembly of the space station. Finally, we get a space station that was really needed for that. And then you will fully, from scratch, completely recertify everything on the shuttle. Show me that your supply chains, everything else, is completely, yeah, whatever. And that would have cost a couple billion dollars. And Accident Investigation Board knew that. And they didn't do it to kill the shuttle, but they said in order for this to get into routine flight. Now, we had flown it 110 times, but it was the recertification that killed it.
Why it crashed? It was something to do with the glass coming loose or something?
On the big orange external tank, this guy here, the big tank on the bottom. Aerodynamic pressure pulled off chunks of it, sometimes just little pieces. In the case of Columbia, a big chunk about that big fell off, smashed into the leading edge of the wing. Most of the people thought that it had hit the bottom side of the shuttle, and those tiles are actually pretty resistant to those kind of impacts. But a piece of foam, even though it only weighed, you know, 1/2 mv², a pound and a half, 2 pounds of foam going about 700 miles an hour, hitting on the leading edge. They weren't tiles. It was actually a pyrolyzed carbon surface. Shattered the front end. When they were coming back, allowed couple thousand degree gases to the inside of the wing, and it burned it out, wing broke off, and the rest is history.
Okay, so the question is, why did that happen then? Was it because there was an intrinsic defect in the design, or it had gotten old?
It was an intrinsic problem. They had several close calls in the past. And one mission in particular just ripped the heck out of the bottom of the shuttle.
So it was a statistical problem. And
yes.
Eventually they rolled the dice
and they lost. But it was a problem that not only were they aware of, they had lots and lots and lots of effort dedicated to fixing it. They knew it was a problem.
Yeah.
And each time they go through another iteration, they think, oh, we've got it. They didn't.
So there was at the end of the day, you would say there was a fundamental fault.
Yes. When you look through what's called the critical items list, what is considered crit one, meaning that if it breaks, you lose the mission, the spacecraft, the crew, there are several hundred of them. What happens if the landing gear doesn't come down? That's pretty critical. You're not going to survive a belly up or a wheels up landing. What would happen if a window shatters? Well, everyone's dead. Ah, you could live with the foam. We never had a problem with the foam until, it was a maintenance issue. We can fix it when we get down. They had tremendous damage with something that was very, very close to what, it was very similar to what happened to Columbia several missions before, and it pulled entire tiles off. Came back fine, just a maintenance issue when you got back. It was far more resilient, which fed into the idea that, we're going to have to be replacing tiles. Okay, let's make certain we have a few new ones sitting around. It was honestly not, as some people, I believe, it wasn't considered an, oh my God, we saw foam come off, they're all going to die. Even though the modeling that they did was imperfect and never had been designed to scale to the size of foam that came off, that model was extremely conservative. Everything that it said, it turned out the damage, in life was far, far less. So they had reasoned engineering thought that, this is not going to be as big of a problem, and obviously it was.
I want to return to my original question.
Okay.
So now we don't have a reusable shuttle.
Right.
We're back to throwaway rockets.
Right.
So in retrospect, was it a good idea to do this?
Yes.
Or were we just kidding ourselves?
Yeah, I honestly think so. Because when you, although it was terribly expensive.
But if it had been a fabulous idea, we would have had the next generation.
Oh, and they were, believe it or not, again, NASA loves paper studies. They were working on a number of them. But again, getting back to let's build a shuttle, what do you want it to do? We're not building a new space station anymore. We're not doing a lot of the stuff. We have two private contractors, Boeing and SpaceX, who are doing our crew transport. What the laws of physics, especially that rocket equation, haven't changed. So if you're going to build another fully reusable shuttle, we all have great ideas. Well, it's going to kind of look like those early concepts, and you're going to have to whittle it down, cost and schedule.
Also, I think there's another thing, that the concept of what you would use space for has maybe evolved.
Hugely.
People talked about this big space station out there.
Yep.
Reality, what space is used is for a million tiny satellites.
In large ways, yeah.
That's the business.
And a couple really big satellites like that behemoth that the military runs, but yes. Yeah. And so, do you have the same, I'm sorry?
Did that fit in the shuttle?
I can't hear.
Did that fit in the shuttle?
The shuttle was designed to carry it. It never did carry that particular one, although it did carry several comparably sized missions, which let's just say all they acknowledge is that it launched and landed and mission accomplished. And of course, you'll never get anything more out of the NRO or anything like that.
On the second disaster, was there any fault with NASA over their risk assessment? I know the first. The temperature situation with the rubber overhang was such that they would say, they'd say, okay, we got a 1 in 10 chance. Now we blew it 5 times, we were successful. They would change the odds and say, now we got a 1 in 500.
Mm-hmm.
But the odds never changed.
Yeah.
Just because you were successful.
Yeah. And again, everything is an independent thing. It's not like it's not like pulling socks out of the dryer combinatorics.
Yeah, where they faltered during the second disaster because the foam had hit before. They knew that this occurred.
No, and there's a lot of good books on the assessment of it. Depending on how you're inclined, you will see it as a horrible indictment. Some are more reasoned. If you are going with, and again, everything is 20/20 hindsight, if you were going with real, with what was known in real time, and yeah, your experience of the past does drive your assumptions for the future. Sometimes they're wrong. They genuinely didn't think that they had the kind of damage that had happened. They had no photographic evidence. As a matter of fact, a picture like this was one of the requirements that came out of it. Now we had really high resolution cameras looking all over the shuttle. If that had been on Columbia, we would have seen it immediately because it was all real time. Here's an interesting thing. With that kind of damage that it did have, and that happened, I think, about 75-ish seconds into the flight, give or take. An abort from there would have caused far greater heating. From the moment that foam hit, you were dead. It's just a matter of how long you're going to wait.
That's right. There's really nothing they could really have done.
If they saw it, there were those...
What they could have done, maybe, was fly to the space station to get away from them.
No. You were in totally different orbits.
Okay.
Very, very different. And one orbit, as an example, is going like this. The other one is like this. In order to get in that same orbital plane is the most fuel-intensive maneuver in spaceflight. It's called a plane change. And then you have to do rendezvous, sync up. You'd probably need another tank of fuel that size in order to perform those maneuvers. They did do, and there I have the paperwork, they have did extensive studies after the fact. Could we have launched a rescue mission, or could, and a separate study was, what could we have done to make the most benign reentry profile ever? And it turns out the shuttle is designed for about as benign as you're going to get. But could you have launched a rescue mission? One shuttle, I think it was Atlantis, was already in the flow. It had about 2.5-3 months to go before it was going to be launched.
What was the answer?
Not a chance. By the time, see, the films for that foam hitting weren't reviewed until 2 or 3 days later. It turned out they didn't, you know, launched on a Friday. They didn't, the management team didn't meet until Monday. Why? Because it's now routine. We don't need to have a meeting.
By the time the film came back from the drugstore, it was already
done. Yeah. From the moment they got into orbit, they immediately powered down and stopped moving, so you're not exercising, so you're not using oxygen. They had a scenario where they threw away every check, every precaution. What could possibly go wrong? In terms of getting the next shuttle out to the pad and launching, they had no procedures on how to do this. They had nothing, but they could maybe have gotten off the ground just as all of their oxygen ran out. But probably not. And it was something that, again, they find, you know, just like everything else, they find dozens of things that need to be addressed in these flows. Oh, well, we have a particular something. We have a, got to replace this part because we can't afford it to break. Now, in a panic rush, you violated all of your safety rules. You still don't know exactly what happened to the shuttle at that time. So now you have that as a big unknown. It could happen again. And now you could have lost two shuttles. The only time, now, all the other missions were strictly limited to going to the space station. At least that safe haven. They did work out procedures for dumping the shuttle into the ocean if it had a problem and the crew just hunkers down in the space station. With the exception of one. One of the last missions, was to go do the last servicing of the Hubble telescope. Nowhere near the space station. And in order to do that, they prepared two shuttles. One of them to do the maintenance, another one rolled out to the other pad, and both of them were on the pad at the same time. If they needed, and they were both prepped, ready to go. If they had a problem with one, we didn't have to wait that compressed 2 or 3 months with all the safety implications on that. We were ready to go within a couple days. And it was called STS-300. That was going to be the rescue mission. And it was fully stocked with everything they needed, extra spacesuits, everything to get people back and forth. And yeah, they took it real seriously after that, but that was the only time they didn't have a safe haven of the space station.
And he also said that whenever after the Challenger, after Columbia, every time they went to the space station, they did a roll around to check because they didn't do that.
Oh, yeah. That's actually a picture of that.
Okay.
That's actually, and then they just rolled around, and they had every camera on space station just going click, 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 and really high resolution. Like, you can read the serial numbers on the tiles, that kind of resolution.
Shouldn't they do it with the doors closed?
No, the doors, first off, those are on the leeward side, not the windward side. They're actually carbon composites, and they only have the lightest thin quartz blankets on them because they don't get that hot. Not that you want to come back with the doors ripped off, but you could sustain a non-trivial amount of damage compared to the rest of the shuttle on the doors. Now, when the doors open, those just aren't doors. If you look, you see those silver panels that would look like the silver insides. Those are actually two things. And underneath it are heat radiators. So when the doors open, a heat radiator pops out to reject all the extra heat, which is one of the big things. And we can talk about fantasy spaceships being built today that don't have heat radiators, and that's going to be a real issue. SpaceX.
Because the spot that piece of foam hit was underneath.
Yeah. Whoops. I did talk about a year ago on Columbia, and the hole was actually either directly on head on the wing or head on the wing or slightly underneath. They did get some ground-based pictures, but they certainly weren't. They might have seen a pixel that looked darker than the others. I mean, these are the resolutions we're talking, because the hole was only about that big, give or take. And at 300 or 400 miles, this big is kind of small. And the shuttle had the upper part facing the Earth, so they never would have seen it because of those. And that would have been tough. But interesting segue on SpaceX. They're building their fantasy rocket. And actually, they had a fun test. Why I'm always entertained at this, effectively, what Elon Musk wants to do is build a second generation shuttle. And combining it with my talk, remember, on the Apollo landings, where we had direct descent and all of that stuff. He is going to realize that he has to go through all of those steps that the shuttle did. Physics and costs don't change. And yeah, things like having real thermal protection, having to decide, other slides which I didn't get into is, do you have tiles insulated or have this incredibly rare, incredibly expensive metallic shingles put on the outside? The X-15 had it. Of course, it wasn't designed for anywhere near the temperatures that the shuttle goes through. So
Do we have any idea what China is doing?
They're not doing anything like this as far as anyone is aware.
Really? That's surprising. I assume that they would take the leadership.
Well, as far as building a shuttle or anything like that,
yeah.
No, not at all. But they just deorbited their third space station. They're working on putting up their fourth. And what's coming up next? They're going to have another moon mission, another landing mission this winter, I think, something like that. Well, the space station, then they send people up and all the rest. I think they've had 6 or 8 flights with... Oh, it's been up there a year or two.
Okay, that's a repeat back out where the dark side.
Yeah, and actually it's in an odd, it's not in an orbit in the traditional sense. And we'll talk a little bit about this next month when I talk about going back to the moon, the new project Artemis. There is an odd balance point, we call it the Lagrange point, where if you can kind of hover around that and you're roughly in balance, but you're not orbiting the body directly. And there's 5 different points. Some are more stable than others.
Your satellite is at one of the Lagrange points.
And it can see both that southern polar area on the moon, on the far side, and also the Earth. And so it acts as a repeater. And they put that up about 6 months, a year before they landed there. So that was good work by the Chinese. I mean, they did real well with that. Correct. Correct. And they got pictures to prove it.
Thank you very much. This was
very good. Well. Yay.